No more shackles, no more chains.
Hey, no more shackles.
put our hands together for Jesus this morning. Our chains are gone. We've been set free. Somebody shout free. He who the sun sets free is free indeed. Yeah. We bless you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. Yeah. Why don't you turn and shake hands with someone before you're seated this morning and say, I've been set free.
I've been set free.
Together in the spirit of unity. Yeah. And isn't it good that we're out here today? Isn't it good? Yeah. Isn't it good? God is good all the time. All the time? He really is. He really is. And we're just glad the weather held up. And I see that there were people out here who didn't want a suntan today, so they didn't sit in the sunny section. This was the Jesus section. A lot of y'all didn't come sit in the Jesus section today. I am Demetrius Warren, and I just want to say, I just want to give a special shout out to all the churches. Acts 2:42. Come on, clap your hands for Acts 2:42. And that is under the pastoral leadership of Pastor Travis and Pastor Casey Klein. We also want to give a shout out to Kokomo Christian Fellowship. Come on, clap your hands for them. Under Pastor Nikki Farmer. And we also have Great Faith, which is, come on, clap your hands for them. Which is Pastor Ramon Oglesby. We also have City of Refuge. Come on, clap your hands. Under Pastor Harry Beard. Church and Everlasting Dominion Fellowship. Come on, clap your hands. And I am Demetrius Warren. I want to share this with you as I introduce the speaker that's coming. Oh, I said that I forget somebody. And fresh start, my boy, Chancellor. Really put us all together, so I guess he deserves more credit than most. Well, God used him to bring us together. I see him shaking his head. No, it wasn't me. It wasn't me. But with our church, just like what is represented out here, the Lord had put in my heart probably about 4 years ago that I didn't want to pastor a black church anymore. I didn't want to pastor a Pentecostal church anymore. What I wanted to pastor was a church that represents the kingdom. And a kingdom church doesn't have a color on it. If there is a color, it's blood and it's red. Under Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And I'm not here to invite you to my church. What I'm saying is, I hope that you go back to your church and you begin to pray as a congregation to say, I don't want to be in a white church. I don't want to be in a black church. I don't want to be in a Hispanic church. I don't want to be in an Asian church. But I want to be in a church that represents the kingdom.
Amen.
That we can have kingdom church. Yeah. And so the Lord led this man into my life. And the only reason why he led him into my life was because he walked in my church and he said the same thing that I've been saying for the last 4 years. And I looked at him and I said, are you ready to pastor? Not sit under me. Be co-pastor with me as we go and tackle this demon of segregation and not understanding each other's race and all this separatism. I said that I will no longer let history describe his story. And the story is about the blood of Jesus shed on Calvary for all of us. And as he began to describe to me what I've been saying for the last 4 years, I said, are you ready to pastor now? And he looked at me and he was like, but you've never heard me preach. And I said, I don't have to hear you preach. You just preached in here when you told me that it was time to have a multiracial, multi-denominational. The only focus is Jesus Christ. We don't care where you come from. We just want to go where Jesus is going with you. And so as I introduce my pastor, Pastor Ryan Howell, will you put your hands together and shout hallelujah? Now stand to your feet. I got to take a picture for my Facebook page. Just wave at me right now. Thank you.
Somebody give it up for Jesus. Somewhat good. I say give it up for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Church, I'm here to tell you we ain't serving no dead God today in this place. And as I look across here and I see multiple churches, and I look across here and I see different races and I see all different things that God's doing, but today I can tell you with a surety that today in Highland Park, the kingdom is here. Man, it was better than that. I said the kingdom is here. And I'm just going to tell you, I'm all the way up here, and y'all, some of you are all the way back there. That just means you're going to have to shout louder. We're going to try it again. We're just going to have to shout a little louder. Okay, there you go. There's three people back over there. One or two over there. That's good. It's an honor and a privilege to stand here before you today. That was a great introduction. Thank you, Pastor Demetrius. And before we get started, when we dive into the Word, I think we need to give honor where honor is due. And all this stuff that you see around here today, guys, this did not just happen by happen chance. This happened because people took some time. They got together. They had meetings. They planned it. And I don't know what everybody is in everybody's role. And I'm not going to start calling out names because I don't want to forget anybody. But if you had a part in planning this or setting this up, would you just stand real quick so we can recognize you? Would you just stand real quick? Go ahead. Go ahead. We got a lot of humble people in the place. Amen. All right, well, we appreciate what you're doing. Let's go to the Word of God today. How many's excited about the Word of God? Yeah. You've got to understand about the Word of God is that it's alive and it is living. That God wants to speak to us this very day. I believe that God has a word for us in this place today, because I believe that God doesn't have his people come together. The Bible says it like this. It says, where two or three are gathered, there he is in his midst. And we got to understand, Christ is here today. Some of us, while we were singing praise and worship, what we started to feel was the presence of God dwelling inside of us. Did anybody feel the presence of God kind of sweep across this place during praise and worship? You may not have liked the style. You may not have liked the one song. They may not have sung your song, but the presence of God was still there. And we got to understand that when we dwell together in unity, in one accord, as one church, God will be present. And I believe God has a word for the church today. I believe God wants to say something to us today. So let's go to the Word of God. If you have your Bibles, turn to Matthew chapter 16. You can do that in the old version form like this. This is a Bible. Or you can do it on your cell phone. Matthew chapter 16, Matthew 16, verses 13 through 19. When you get there, say amen. Amen. If you're not there, say hold on. All right, we'll hold on just one more second here. And just so you know, I'm part of the way in the sun and part of the way not, so we'll be done in 15 minutes or I'll be sunburned. Matthew 16, 13 through 19 says this. I'm reading from the New King James Version. It says, when Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, who do men say that I am? The Son of Man am. So they said, some say John the Baptist, some say Elijah, others say Jeremiah, and one or one of the prophets. He said unto them, but who do you say that I am? So it first was, who do others say that I am? The next statement is, who do you say that I am? You see that? And then he says, Simon Peter answered him and said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Hallelujah. Jesus answered and said to him, blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who's in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. What rock is he talking about? He's talking about the revelation of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. And the gates of hell shall not prevail. Now that's right there. The gates of hell will not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatsoever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. And whatsoever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. It's anointed. We thank you for this chance for all of us as churches, as the kingdom, as your body, Father, to gather together in this place. Now, Father, we ask for you to just move in our hearts. Let us, our hearts receive this word that you would have for us today. Lord, we know that you want to speak through your word. So, Father, help prepare us to receive it, and we'll thank you for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Everybody said, amen. Amen. So the first thing Jesus said, they're on a trip, and he pulls his disciples together. So there's 12 guys standing around Jesus. And Jesus says this. He says, who do others say that I am? Now, I want to talk about this idea of who do others say that Jesus is. I Googled it. Anybody ever use Google? Good. I'm just making sure you guys are still with me, okay? So I Googled it, and I said, who is Jesus? And I Googled it, and roughly 605 million responses came back with people that had wrote letters or notes or whatever in the internet that said that who Jesus was. So there is definitely no lacking in who this Jesus that we serve is. Are you guys with me? See, we realize that to certain religions, he's a prophet. To other religions, he's a teacher. To some people, he was a great person. To some other people, he was a great leader. But to some people, he's Lord and he's Savior. And he's King of Kings and he's Lord of Lords. And that's who we're serving in the place today. Are you with me? And so what we realize is that the first thing it says is that when he asked them, who do men say that I am? They had no problem talking. All the disciples started talking. People started saying all kinds of things. The first thing they said that some call you Herod. I'm sorry. The first thing he said was that some call you John the Baptist. And historians will tell you that this idea came from Herod himself, the king. And so we realize that what it's trying to tell us first is that the leadership of the nation, the king, and then the people through the kingdom, they were all saying the same thing. They think that this Jesus guy is John the Baptist. Now, John the Baptist was dead, but they thought somehow John the Baptist had reincarnated in this, and at best, this Jesus was a prophet. And so they say he's John the Baptist. And so you understand that the kingdom and the kings and the people in high authority all thought that this Jesus guy was nothing more than a prophet. The popular mainstream people all believed that it was Elijah. Everybody say Elijah. Elijah was the prophet that came and went up into heaven. He was translated. He never tasted death. And so the modern religion people, the typical religious person at the time, would have told you there's a good chance that this guy here is Elijah. So at best, they said he was another prophet. None of them had crossed and translated or had this idea yet that Jesus was the Christ. And so we go a little bit further and we see that other ones said he could be Jeremiah or the other prophets. And this came from a wise tale that came within some of the very strict and religious circles where these people had studied the Bible and they'd taken a few verses here and there. And with inside of those verses, they said that based upon their translation of scripture, they believed that this guy named Jesus could have been Jeremiah or one of the prophets. In other words, nobody had known Jesus yet to this moment as Christ. So who are we saying, church, that Jesus is? Who are we saying that this Jesus is? See, if we're not careful, it's real close. We can walk around and we can talk about who is this guy, Jesus. Because we can all go to our own church and say, Jesus is the God we serve. But in order for him to be God in this house, we're going to get our shout on. We can go and we can say, Jesus was Baptist. Some would say Jesus was Pentecostal. Some would say Jesus was this or that or what have you. And I'm not saying that if you believe that Jesus isn't Lord. But what I am saying is that we have taken the idea of Jesus and put our own spin on it. And if we're not careful, we've taken Jesus down to something that he's not. We put barriers up that we have to come to Jesus in a certain way, form, or fashion. We have to worship a certain way. We have to play a certain song. We have to pay a certain amount in the offering plate. We sometimes have to dress a certain way. Sometimes you have to go to a certain place because your friendly or your family or your friends go there. We've taken this concept of Jesus sometimes and we've twisted it and we put religion into it and we put our own ideas and we put our own methods and our own ways into it. And what we did was we built church walls up and we put around it. We put a big sign in front of our church and we said First Church of the Pentecostals or First Church of the Baptists. In other words, if you want to have the full revelation of Jesus, we have it, but it's through a certain form or fashion. Are you with me? And so we're really no different sometimes than what happened here. And Jesus sometimes, I wonder, would look at us and say, who do others say that I am? And the way they're getting their information is from the church. So we've taken Jesus and we built walls up and we said, this is the way you worship Jesus. And I'm all for diversity in the body and I'm all for unity in the body as well. I'm all for different churches having different worship styles. I think that's beautiful. I'm all for people having different excitement and expressions. And if you're comfortable with that, that's fine. If you're not, that's fine too. Some people like to shout and jump up and down and pump their fists for Jesus. Some people like to stand in reverence for Jesus. And here's what I'm telling you. If you're worshiping Jesus, go for it.
Amen. All right.
But we built up walls and we made buildings. And each building has a different name. There was a church or a place in another town, not Kokomo. We wouldn't do this in Kokomo, I'm sure. No. But there was another town I drove by and it was like the First Church of something. And then I drove by a little bit down the block and there was the Second Church of something. And then, no kidding, this honest to God's truth, I drove a little bit further around the other side and it said the Greater First Church of something. And I thought, I wonder how many church splits happened right there. But we have miscommunicated who this Jesus the Christ is. Because we've all decided to build up these buildings. But when I look here today, I realize the church has left the building. That's a good place to shout right there if you're a shouting church. So we know the church has left the building. I look across Kokomo right now, and I'm so excited to be pastoring in Kokomo, Indiana. I've got friends across the state, some across the nation, and what's going on in Kokomo right now is not happening in some other places. There's a movement called Revive Indiana, and they came through a few months ago, and it brought churches together, and we started to join and became friends with churches that turns out they were cool. Turns out some of you are really okay. Turns out some of us are okay. Some of us are a little more well-tied than others. nervous. Some get more excited than others, but it's okay. And we learned that through some Revive Indiana. There's the Kokomo Great Banquet community that's coming together. And we see how thousands of people are gone through the Kokomo Great Banquet, and they start to get their lives shook because all their doctrine and all that stuff starts to peel away as they come in, and all they do is just lift up Jesus' name and in the love and the grace of God pursue him. So we have those two things. We got other things going on. There's a 24-hour-a-day, 7-day-a-week prayer meeting going on in Kokomo right now. It started 2 weeks ago, and it's out on the church on the east side. And they just said, we're just going to start praying, and whenever it ends, it ends. And for 2 weeks, everybody say 2 weeks.
2 weeks.
2 weeks. I talked to the pastor the other day. They've had between 2 and 32 people on their face before the Lord interceding for Kokomo. Now see, it's better than that. That's where you should get excited. Because what we're seeing happen in the church today is not the buildings and the walls going up. It's not us dividing amongst and saying you're wrong and we're wrong or whatever it looks like. What you're seeing happen in Kokomo today is that we've had this revelation of who Jesus is, and we are identifying him as properly as people. We're learning that Jesus Christ is the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings, and we're breaking down everything else, and God is unifying the body of Christ in Kokomo. Now, it doesn't take a genius to figure that out. Just look around. There are at least 6 different churches here that were just planning this. There's some other people that I've seen that pastor other churches that I've seen you out and about here. I'll shake your hand later. But I've seen some different people from different churches. I don't know how many different churches are represented here today. But what I can tell you is that we know that we serve the same King of Kings and Lord of Lords.
Hallelujah.
And so what we've learned so far is that the first thing Jesus said is, who do others say that I am? And those people no doubt learned it from the religious folk. And so then he turns onto his disciples. They had no problem telling him who others said he was. But then Jesus says, who do you say that I am? Now, these are his friends. They've been traveling with him for a long time. And all of a sudden, they go silent. What awkward silence this must have been. All of them looking around. Nobody says anything. Now, it's amazing to me that when they first say, who do men say that I am? Everybody has something to say. The Bible doesn't distinguish what they said or who said what. But all of a sudden, 11 of them are silent when they say, who do you say that I am? And then Peter says it. He says the statement of the century, or the statement of all ages. Peter looks at him and he says, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And the revelation was there, because for the first time, he was no longer a prophet. For the first time, it was not about religiosity. For the first time, it was just about Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. Yeah. And what we see is that Jesus takes great delight in hearing this. Because Jesus goes on and he says this, blessed are you, Simon. He said, because flesh and blood has not revealed this to you. In other words, nobody taught this to him. It wasn't doctrine up in all kinds of doctrine and religious. It was all just basically the fact that Jesus or the Father revealed it to Peter himself. And so we realize that when we really get the concept that Jesus Christ is Lord of all, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, when we get that concept, when it's revealed to us not through flesh and blood, I can't teach this. Nobody can teach this to you. When you really get the revelation of Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of your life, and when you really understand that he's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, when you really understand he's the Son of the living God, when you get all of that, this is what starts to translate right here. This is called unity. We learn in the Bible, it says that we are not to grieve the Holy Spirit. When you read through those verses, the next few verses start to talk about what that grieving the Holy Spirit is. And see, church, what we have to understand is for years, I believe we've grieved the Holy Spirit. I know in Pentecostal churches, they say those things and just don't grieve the Holy Spirit. Don't grieve the Holy Spirit. But when you read in the rest of the scriptures, it tells us that the way we grieve the Holy Spirit is when we have evil intentions inside of us and when we don't get along with one another.
Yes.
What would it look like for us to start to actually dwell in unity as a church, not as an individual church, but as a corporate church in Kokomo? What would it look like for us to all have the same revelation of Jesus Christ when other people start to ask us who he is? What would it look like if all of us had the same story and the same testimony when they said, who is this Jesus Christ, that he could gather a couple hundred people in Highland Park on a Sunday at morning when it's a little bit hot and it's a little bit sticky and there's some people that's willing to even sit in the sun? And who is this Jesus Christ? And all of us at the same time could stand up today and say that Jesus Christ is the Savior of the world and the Son of the living God. Jesus didn't stop there. He didn't just stop at the revelation of who he was. Because what Jesus did next was amazing. He told Peter this amazing church growth strategy. He said, on this revelation, on this rock, that I am the Son of God. He said, on that rock, I'm going to build my church. I'm telling you, I got out of seminary a few years ago, and a couple of the books I read for seminary, you had to read hundreds of books. I mean, I got a couple bookshelves full of books that I read for seminary. And somehow, in each one, they wanted to have all kinds of church growth strategies. And I'm telling you, there's as many church growth strategies as you could ever imagine. Everybody has their own way of how to grow a church. But how many of you guys like Jesus' way of how to grow a church? And what Jesus said is this, is when we have the rock in our church, and when the rock that we are built on is the revelation that Jesus Christ is the Christ and the Son of the living God, the church is going to grow. When we have that revelation that Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God and that he is the Christ, the Savior of the world. When we have that revelation, church, denominations will cease to exist. When we have that revelation, church, what we will see is that the body of Christ will be built up. And it's not that it just gets built up so more people come to our church services. It's not that it just gets built up so that we can take in more money and do more programs. It's not that it just gets built up so that we can all talk about how big of a flock we shepherd. It's that it gets built up not only to exist to evangelize the lost, but it also gets built up as a victorious church. Because what it says next is that the kingdom of hell cannot prevail against it. Sorry, I'm getting kind of excited up here. We got a cool breeze kind of coming across here. Got me a nice little breather there for just a second. But what it says is that the gates of hell will not prevail against the church. And we have to understand this, church, because I believe we've seen all kinds of things attack the church. And we've seen the church try to be destroyed for ages, thousands of years, 2,000 to be exact. This idea has tried to attack the church. The society has tried to snuff out the message of Jesus Christ. The governments have tried to snuff out the message of Jesus Christ. There's been people that have been died and martyred, and it goes on every day, even to this very day, because of the revelation of Jesus being the Christ. But the gates of hell will not prevail. What does it look like, church, for us in Kokomo? What does it look like, church, for us in Kokomo? To not talk about our differences, but together, when we come together, just lift up Jesus Christ. What does it look like? Could you imagine what the church of Kokomo, big church, corporate church of Kokomo, would look like if all we did was just got together and talk about how great our God is? Whatever method or manner you want and whatever you're comfortable with, go for it. But what if we just focus on what brings us together, and that is Jesus Christ as the Son of the living God? Amen. So he says this, so we understand that he's the Son of the living God, he's Jesus Christ, and there's so much in that. It means he's the King of Kings, he's the Lord of Lords. It means that he's Lord and Savior. He's not just there to bail you out, but he's there to bail you out and be Lord of your life. That means that he's there to save us of our sins. That means he's there to pour out his Holy Spirit upon us and charge us to be witnesses to the community. That means that he's put gifts inside of each one of us so that we could better serve our mankind around us in the proximity of where we live and where we work. We should be understanding that when you come to Jesus Christ, that we become missionaries on a 24/7 mission field, that wherever you go, wherever it looks like, wherever you work, wherever your feet go, you are walking in a place where you can be the light of the world, where you can shine for Jesus, where you can let that Holy Spirit that's inside of you shine. And all we have to know, listen, you don't have to go to seminary to be able to tell somebody about Jesus. All we have to do is let the love of Christ shine through us and just let people know that it's for Jesus. The Bible says it like this in John 13:35. It says that we will know them, but he says this about his disciples. They will know you're my disciples because you love one another. Because when we love, that's when we're most like Jesus. And so we've learned that on this rock, he will build his church. The very rock of who Jesus Christ, on that rock and that revelation alone, he'll build his church. Not on anything else. And then he goes on and he says this, and this is where I'm going to wrap up here in just a second, but it says this. He says, I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. The keys to the kingdom of heaven. And what I really want you to understand about this is this, guys. Keys are given to people with authority. And when I say that, I'm not talking about you have authority to start naming it and claiming it, blab it and grab it, or anything like that. I'm not talking about you got the right to start going around and quoting scriptures and taking them out of context and starting to get your Cadillac. That's not what I'm talking about. What I'm talking about is when we become identified with Jesus, we become an heir and a joint heir with him. And what I'm talking about is that when we start to understand and have the revelation of Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, when we have that revelation, when we have that relationship, when we have that concept, when we have that idea, then he gives us authority. And that authority is not for us to go walking around. That authority is for us to go out and share it with people. That authority is for us to walk out and say, I'm one of the king's kids. That means that we can go out on our workplace where all that ho-worker that drives you nuts. Anybody know what I'm talking about? When you go to the one honest person. The co-worker that drives you nuts. You can go out to him. And you can go and show him the love of Christ. Why? Because he's given us the authority to do so. He's given us the keys to the kingdom. In other words, guys, he's literally trusted us with this message of Jesus Christ's salvation. Now, most fundamental Christians would tell you this, that there's a heaven and a hell. And most fundamental Christians would tell you this, that inside of the choice of heaven or hell, there's only one way to heaven. And I'm here to tell you, I believe that. I believe there's only one way to heaven. And I believe that's through the blood of Jesus Christ. I believe that. And we believe that, and we read our Bibles, and we go to church, and we take in these scriptures, and we do this all the time. Some of us go to church two or three times a week. Some of us hear two or three sermons a week. Some of us are really super saved, and we hear more sermons than that. We listen to them on our iPod. We listen to them on our drive to work. We listen to them on the radio. Some of us read scriptures all the time. Some of us pray all the time. Some of us got all the New York Times Christian bestseller books on our bookshelves. And some of us go through all this religious ritual, and I'm not telling you that any of that's bad. But what I am trying to tell you is this, is that when all you really need to know in order to be the effective light to the world is that Jesus Christ is the Christ and the Son of the living God. And by your understanding and your revelation of that, he's given you the keys so that you can unlock the door to bring other people into the kingdom. Are you with me? Amen. So let's do this. Let's stand all over the house as I wrap up here. I say over the house. I'm used to preaching in church. Sorry. Let's stand all over the park. There's three things I want to talk about here. I want to talk to the people because I believe that this revelation of Jesus Christ has to be made. And there may be people in the place today that say, I don't even know what you're talking about. I just came out because I heard there was a lot of good food. And listen, when church people get together, one of the amazing blessings is that church people know how to cook. They know how to cook, and praise God for that. And if you look around, some of us can just have the idea that church people know how to eat too. Church people can cook and eat, and that's a blessing, and that's important. That's called fellowship. But here I want to talk in three levels about this, about who Jesus Christ is to you, three different places. Number one, I want to talk individually to each individual person here today. Individually, who is Jesus Christ to you? Who is he in your life? Is he just somebody you come to church for? occasionally, but through Monday through Saturday, it's just you just live life as normal. Is if you ever had an interaction with Jesus Christ that literally you can say it's changed your life and it's taken you in a different direction. I'm going to talk to those people for just a second. If you're in this place today and you say, I don't understand what you're talking about having a radical encounter with Jesus and about giving my life to him and about turning some situations over, if you don't know what I'm talking about, we're going to have the pastors come up here in just a second. Or pastors, if you want to make your way this direction, we're going to give you an opportunity to come pray. Secondly, I want to talk to individual churches. You may say that inside of your church that you may be the only right one. And if that's you today, I'm really asking you to pray. Because we got to understand, church, that we are a corporate church. This is a citywide church. Jesus Christ did not die on the cross for one church. He died on the cross for the world. And it's us, guys. We hold the keys to the kingdom of heaven. And by all of this stuff that we're doing, guys, by all this stuff that we're trying to put up walls and barriers, we're making ourselves look so foolish. What is it that we have that the world doesn't? What is it that we have that the world just wishes that they had? And sometimes I wonder if we have anything at all. But I can tell you with a surety today, folks, that the thing that we have that the world as we know it does not have is that we have the idea that Jesus Christ, he's the Christ, and he's the Son of the living God. And if you're in this house today and you say, I want to know who that is, then we want to invite you up here to pray with somebody. If you're in this place today and you're just saying, man, listen, I don't even know if anything I said even affected you. But if you're in the place today and you're just saying, man, life is tough. Life is tough. How many of you guys know life gets tough sometimes? And when life gets tough, sometimes we get overwhelmed. And sometimes we don't know what to do next. And sometimes your victory may look a little different. Sometimes your walk may look a little bit different. Sometimes it's a little tougher. But in this place today, guys, listen, as we reflect on some of the words that were said here today, we want to just give an opportunity for anybody who needs prayer for anything. We're going to open this up. Anybody who wants to pray, just come forward and just listen to the song and let's reflect on this word that we've received today. Not that I was some great orator or anything like that, but really reflect on the idea of, is Jesus Christ Lord of your life? Is he Lord in your situation? Is he Lord in everything? Do we have that revelation yet? If not, we invite you forward or for anything else. Let's reflect on this word as we hear this song play. Leaders in this community will begin to pray with you and for you. So let's join together as the church this morning. We're a mighty force. God invites us into the throne room of grace. He says that we can come boldly into his throne room. We can come boldly in a place of prayer and submission before him as our Father. How many of you believe today that we are one church? Amen. Amen. We're serving one Father. Amen. Amen. There's one access to the Father, and it's through Jesus. And he's given us the power of his Holy Spirit. So in this moment, we're relying on the Holy Spirit to unite us together as the church. So let's pray. Father, we welcome you and thank you that you are here. We thank you for your word that has been spoken today into our hearts. Now, Lord, as we move into this time of prayer for one another, we thank you, Lord, that you're hearing our petitions and you're hearing our prayers. And Lord, as we as leaders speak, Father, we speak praying that it's from our hearts, God, your heart that is being proclaimed into this city and into our churches, God. It's your heart to unite us together as one. So Lord, today as we reach out and touch someone around us and listen to what their needs are, Lord, we're going to lift them up before you. So God, this hour when we pray, we ask, Lord, that your will would be done. We give you the honor. We give you the glory. And the church said, amen. Amen. Now, why don't you just begin to move as Pastor Ramon leads us in prayer. As you begin to move, just ask what we could pray with you about and begin to be the hands and feet of Jesus and pray with one another.
Father, in Jesus' name, we humbly come to you because we have no other place we can go. God, there are different ones in this audience today who have several different needs. They have things going on, God, that there is absolutely no way that we can individually know them all. But God, that's the reason why we look to you. Because you know every single detail about us. God, you know every hair that we've grown and every hair that we've lost. You have not been out of contact with us. So God, we come to you because you're the only help we know. We look to the hills from which cometh our help. Hallelujah. And God, right now, as that person is praying for a person that they may not know, as they're praying for a person who they may not have identity with in any other area, God, I pray right now that the connection and the identity be with you, be through you, through your blood. God, we're pleading the blood of Jesus over the situation that we're praying for right now. Come on, somebody just say the blood of Jesus. When we don't know what to pray, we pray the blood of Jesus and let the Holy Ghost make intercession for us. Hallelujah. The blood of Jesus covers now from the top of their head to the soles of their feet. Whatever their perplexities are, whatever their situations are, whatever the problems are, God, we cancel them in Jesus' name. We call the devil to cease and desist off of the children of God right now. And we plead the blood of Jesus over every situation, over every circumstance in Jesus' name. And we give you glory, God, for victory. We give you glory, God, for liberty and freedom in the Holy Ghost in Jesus' name.
Father, even as we pray, there is a son, a daughter, a grandchild that did not come out here tonight, and there's a family member that is here that is concerned about their grandchild or their son or their daughter. Father, we lift up all the children that are not here today. Father, we come together in agreement that, oh God, that they belong to you. And right now, oh God, we ask that you would snatch them out of drugs. Snatch them out of illicit relationships. Snatch them, oh God, where they're mentally, where their mental capabilities are not, they're not able even to see you right now. And Father, we plead the blood of Jesus over their lives, over their hearts, over their homes right now. Do healing in families, healing in marriages right now. In the name of Jesus, there are many blended families, oh God, where the children don't feel like they're loved by the stepmom or the stepdad. Right now, in the name of Jesus, we ask for a covering and protection over all the families of this city right now, in the name of Jesus. Where somebody's heart is broken right now, where somebody gave up right now, where somebody doesn't even believe in you right now, send your ministering angels right now in the name of Jesus. Father, we speak it and we believe it done in your precious name.
Yes. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you. John 17 chapter said that they all may be one, as you and the Father are in me, and I in you, that they also may be one in us, so that the world may know, may believe, and be convinced that you have sent me. Father, in Jesus' name, we come before you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for this day that you've given us, this great, this glorious day, O Lord, that you have brought us together. It's because of your divine power and your glory, Lord, that you have brought us to this place, Lord. And we want to thank you. Can the church just say thank you?
Thank you.
We're going to praise and pray through praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Come on, church. Just open your mouth and praise him for me. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
There's power in your praise. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you for what you're doing, oh God, today. Thank you, Lord, for how you have broken down barriers. You've opened doors, oh God. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you for your goodness and your mercy, Lord. Thank you for your power, Lord. Thank you for your saving grace. Thank you, Lord, for being so good, oh Lord. Thank you, Lord, for being in control of every situation that we're in. Now, Lord, we ask that you will bless your people now. In the name of Jesus, I pray, Lord, that you would tear down every barrier and every wall that will stop the kingdom of God. In the name of Jesus, bind the devil, Lord. Cast him out. In the name of the Lord Jesus, Satan, I rebuke you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we plead the blood. Unify us now, Lord, with your love, oh God, with your peace, with your joy. And we know that you're the God that's able. We're trusting in you, Lord. We're leaning on you, Lord. We're looking to you because you're God. There's none other like you. None can be compared to you. Now, Lord, perform it. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Thank God.
Father, you desire obedience over sacrifice. And God, right now, help us listen. You need obedient people. And Lord, right now, we are part of something special. But Lord, this is just a morning on a Sunday. And you have called us to so much more on Monday and Tuesday and the rest of the week and month and year, Lord. This community needs you. And I pray that we would be obedient. Lord, we need to step up to the challenge that you've put before us. We need to step up to the things you've called us to. As men and women and families and churches in this community, God, you have called us to certain things. And Jesus, we ask right now that we would help us listen to you. Show us the way. Give us the wisdom that we need. Thank you for the power that you give us to follow your way. In Jesus' name, help us listen. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Dear Father God, we thank and praise you for the opportunity to gather together in the name of Jesus Christ, to call upon you together. We pray for your church. You prayed for your church. We pray for your church. We pray for ourselves, Lord. May your bride make herself ready. Amen.
Lord. How many of you all feel better after worshiping a holy God? I like that. I want to hear that a little bit more. Give me a little bit more, though. That's praise to God. That's what he's been waiting on all day. Let's give it to him again. The Bible says, clap your hands, all ye people, and shout unto God. Wow! With a voice of triumph. Victorious people in the house, woo! Or in the park. Bless the Lord.
A little bit of rust in the bottom, so it is a little color today, but it is clean water, and it's just a symbolic representation that Christ cleanses us. Amen. And because he cleanses us, again, we're following biblical instruction to baptize. And so I have Nick standing beside me, who has professed Christ as the Lord of his life. And it's been a beautiful thing to watch Brady and Nick just allow the word of the Lord to transform them and begin to change them. They're hungry for God. They're getting into his scriptures, asking questions. And because of that, it's an honor to stand beside him today. And so, Nick, is there something you'd like to share with us today about what Christ is doing in your life?
If you'd told me 4 months ago that I'd be here today, being baptized, I wouldn't have believed you. I was back then, I was doing a lot of things. Well, shouldn't have been doing. And the Lord showed me the way. And,
Amen.
And I'm here today because of the Lord. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Jesus Christ is the Lord of your life. We're going to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Shed for all of us, and it's awesome when a young person says, I want to live for Jesus. And that's what Drew has said. He says, I want to live for Jesus.
Amen.
He said, I want to make Jesus the Lord of my life. And as he has, I'm thankful for parents who teach the Word of God and lead their children in the way of God. And that's what we see in this Gingrich family, is we see a passion and a love for God, and it's truly an honor to stand beside his father in this moment to baptize his son. But before we do that, Drew, is there anything you'd like to say about your relationship with Christ and what he means to you?
Don't be afraid, because God is always with you.
Amen.
Yeah, is there anything you'd like to say?
I'm certainly proud of the Father to be here today, and I just thank the Lord that his grace is sufficient each and every day, and it's an honor to have my son commit his life to him, and it's a blessing. I'm glad for each of you here that today is a witness that that Drew is turning his life to the Lord. Thank you.